Last week, Jeremy went fox hunting in a range of off-roaders and reckoned the voluminous Toyota Land Cruiser came out on top. But there was no discovery in the group because the new one had yet to be launched. And Land Rover had brought me here to the bleak beauty of the Scottish Highlands to try it out. No foxes, no Quentin, no Vicky, and no new discovery. Hold on a minute. Those door handles look a bit different, and that light cluster wasn't up there before, was it?
Yes, the new discovery looks just like the old one. All the body panels are new, and the disco now has flush-fitting glass. But apart from that, it's a spot-the-difference competition that you'd probably lose.
Engine-wise, the choice is still either V8 petrol or turbo diesel. And as 85% of disco sales go to people who are apparently more concerned with the 3 and 6 they save on annual fuel costs rather than the discomfort they cause others with their noise and obnoxious fumes, I suppose I'd better try the diesel first.
The engine is a totally new 5-cylinder 2.5-litre, and no, it's not a BMW unit. But it is quieter, cleaner, has 20% more torque, and with 136 bhp, 20% more power.
And the difference is a revolution. This engine is really keen to rev. It seems to want to get up and go. You might actually now be able to overtake safely in a Discovery without needing a 1 mile straight to do it in. But in the end, a diesel is still a diesel. So let's move on to more interesting things. Because it wasn't just the diesel engine that was bad in the old Discovery. The on-road handling was pretty awful as well. Go around corners as anything above crawler pace, and the old disco was all rock and roll. But all that's changed as well.
By using a system like that in the Citroën Activa, hydraulically actuated control modules virtually eliminate body roll in normal cornering, and all of a sudden, you've got a Discovery that handles.
Unfortunately, behind the wheel are a few minor niggles. I'd like the seat to be able to go back a bit further, and there's very little room for your foot to the left of the clutch pedal. And this steering wheel has got to be the worst I've ever driven with. It seems to have been put on upside down. It's designed for your hands to slip off it, and every time you turn a corner your palm hits the horn buttons, and this huge center with the steering wheel up in my driving position actually blocks out the bottom half of the dash display sometimes. Well, if I've been impressed even by this turbo diesel, the V8 should be something rather special. After the surprising performance of the diesel, this 4-litre V8 is almost something of a disappointment. OK, it's got a fraction more power and a bit more torque, but what you really want is the extra 40 horsepower of the 4.6-litre Range Rover unit. In fact, this V8 is only about 3 seconds faster to 60 than the diesel and does at least 10 miles less to the gallon. Personally, I never have had that much faith in market research, and I don't think that the old Discovery looks are going to do the new Discovery any favours, especially after the fresh image created by the Freelander.
But as a driver's car, there's no doubt it sets new standards for the future. There is still that little worry about Land Rover build quality, but if they get that right, the Disco will be in a class of its own when it goes on sale at the end of November.
And, of course, for the few off-road buyers who actually take their vehicles off-road, nothing does it better than a Land Rover.
with its on-road anti-roll system automatically disconnecting as the sensors realise the vehicle is off-road, the Discovery is now possibly the most capable of all the Land Rover range. Not only does it have the superb hill descent of the Freelander, but it also has its own brand new electronic brake distribution, which provides each wheel with its own individual traction control. It's all very impressive.